Hi, I'm Alex, and I'm here at the Gogosiat Natural Resource Center, just about to get ready to enter the information community session.
Welcome on LBDIO, on this chilly Monday night. First of all, I wanted to say last week, it's Gesgapegiag Tourism's one-year anniversary. Congratulations. So, in this past year, we first met with the gang up here in late February, and we started talking about, we initially called everyone here to help solutions for the energy problems at Relais de la Cache. I'm not sure if you're aware, but Relais de la Cache is being run right now on a diesel generator that has proven to be unreliable, and it's definitely given us some problems over the past year, and many headaches for cache manager Josh here, but we're able to come together to hopefully find a solution for the Relais de la Cache. And 1 year later, here we are. We hope that a lot of the information that we're able to present tonight is informative, useful, and hopefully we can fulfill the needs of the energy problems at Relais de la Cache. Maybe we can go around and just do a quick introduction before we get started. So,
Josh Bradford, manager of the cache. I would just like to say that he touched on a bit is us as a Micmac people, we're protectors of the land. We have to show examples, not to just our community, but communities around, non-native and native. If we can get this project going, we'll be the first of our kind. And we have some great people here to assist us with this project. So without further ado, I'd like to, for them to introduce themselves.
Yes. Hi, I am François Boivin from the FNQLSDI, which is the First Nation. First Nation Sustainable Development Commission. Yeah, sorry. I've been with them for 2 months now. I'm doing all the projects related to renewable energy. So my colleague Isabelle Rochet started this project last year with the community and Jessica that will present itself later on. And then I took the job in November, and now I'm doing this project with the Gesgapegiag community. So I will be presenting tonight what we did with the Jessica to replace the generator and make a great example of this project.
Okay, my name is Matthew Wadam-Gagnon. I'm from Jessica. Nashika, it used to be called the Technocentre Prévoyer. We're based in Gaspé. We're a research center, non-profit. I'll tell you a little bit more about us in a few minutes. But yeah, we got on board with this on this project with the DDI, the First Nations of Quebec and Labrador Sustainable Development. About a year ago, came out to meet Josh and Sam, Walter, and most recently with Bonnie and Paul. Yeah. So I'll let Francois and then I'll come back to the class a little bit more after.
All right. Sam, yeah, well, Sam, you'll begin. I guess we got a person manager been working on this project since the beginning. And not sure if you touched on that. Josh explained it, but just to make it clear, Relais de la Cache is completely off the grid. All the electricity we're producing ourselves through two diesel generators that are not basically done. We're currently leasing a diesel generator in the meantime that we figure out what we want to do in the long term. So it's,
All right. let's get started. So, just for my introduction, some of you know the FNQ MSDI already, I think. So there's a new, we present 10 nation poetry communities in Quebec and Labrador. And myself, like I say, it's a new opening, it's a new field of expertise for the institute about renewable energy. So, it's a service of supporting the action of the communities, developing sustainable communities, and promoting the recognition of their rights to the land, to whatever. we do this technical advice, recommendation, work and information, developing events, support and consulting in all the aspects that you can see, which is climate change, strategic environmental planning, waste management, impact and benefits, agreements, cement efficiency, comprehensive community planning, mining and abandoned sites, and consultation. So that's basically what we do.
And Nershika, as I mentioned, is it's a natural progression of the technological game. We were mainly focused on wind energy up until maybe a couple of years ago. Today we're focused to cover solar, microgrids as well. We'll explain that in a few minutes. We're primarily a research center. We also do technical assistance, technical transfer, knowledge transfer, training, and our mission really is to create new opportunities for renewable energies. And we work primarily with businesses and communities. As I mentioned before, we work in wind energy, solar energy, as well as what we call the integration of renewables to electricity. That all means microgrids in a way. As Sam mentioned, in Canada there are nearly 300 communities that are off-grid. So they mainly operate off of diesel generators. It's a huge opportunity for us as Canadians to integrate renewables. We're working with, we've been working with communities in northern Quebec, as well. We've been working with Francois, and most recently with your community, Gesgapegiag. Any of you have been to Gesgapegiag and seen there's two wind turbines near Gabon now? Those two wind turbines belong to us. So this is a picture of our test site. You'll probably also see, maybe right here, you can see another smaller wind turbine. The two big ones are 2 megawatt turbines, so similar in size to the ones that are in big wind farms in the Gaspé Peninsula. These two little ones here are 25 kilowatt wind turbines. This is a microgrid that we have, so this microgrid has diesel generators, it has a couple wind turbines, we have energy storage, and the idea, we have a research project that where the objective is to integrate these renewable energies and to reduce the diesel consumption of generators. The idea here is to simulate a small community or a small, maybe an industry or something, and see how we can integrate renewables to reduce their diesel consumption. We've also recently added about 15 kilowatts of solar panels on this site. They were commissioned, I think, in November 2017. And so this is part of our program to add solar to wind, to the energy mix, see how it all works together. So that's us in a nutshell.
So the origin of the FN2SDI being part of this project is last year. My colleague Isabelle did a podcast. She went around many communities in Quebec to see what the needs in renewable energy were from the communities. And why she was here, she was talking with them. And the need for the Relais Lacache was identified. So we started this project so that the podcast we did, the objective were to define the availability and the use of energy, which in the case, the Lacache is diesel, and the use is for many well, the restaurants and the hotel and the future gas station. That's it. So the needs, inform and raise awareness about renewable energy, which is the part that I'm going to start doing soon, is going around the communities and deliver training and information for general people, or workers, or people that have cabins and chalets and want to integrate the renewable energy in the territory. So this is the next step that we start in March. So that's in this particular project, it's a part of Natural Resources Canada funding, which is paying for the okay and everything. And for the Relais Lacache, there's a program that is called Innovative Demonstration Program. And this is why we went to get NERJICA, because the Relais Lacache program is not only to install solar panels, but really the panels we go is about getting a microgrid, getting innovative development that can be duplicated, that is unique for now in Quebec. So this is why we apply to the federal government funding, which is Spain's biggest chunk of the project. We can go back on that. So this program is aimed only for a road-sized off-grid that will replace, the objective is to replace diesel with renewable and to be innovative. If the project is not innovative, it won't be accessible for everyone to access. Why the project at the Relais Lacache? Well, the Relais Lacache has one main lodge and with restaurant and open rooms. There's four rooms, a new motel, there's a gas station, and the community has expansion plans for it, which includes exactly what it is. Power is delivered by two diesel generators, which consume around 10 to 12,000 liters of diesel a year. And as Josh said, there's a great idea. That's helpful. Related problems with the generator. So sometimes they go very low. They have these ones because they were not worth it. So the main phase of the project we're looking at is over many years, because we first have in 2019-2020 the project design, the microgrid design, optimize the when we're going to do the design and the planning of the project. We want to optimize about the hiring of the people, so we have to work a schedule that we allow the project that the community to hire as many people locally as possible. So this sometimes asks for optimization in the planning and the schedule, not interfere with the Relais Lacache activities too. So we're going to take the rest of the year, because we will know if the project is, if the project goes forward and it's accepted, then we'll have a few months to plan all that.
When you say hiring people, for what type of position?
We'll come back at that point later. Yes, we have a sign on that.
Okay.
All right. 2020-2021 is project implementation, which is construction, wiring, power on, and commissioning. 2020-2021. 2021-2023 is the research project, which is optimization of the microgrid, energy management from energy company, and optimization towards the purpose of renewable. Because even if you go with the project and install solar panels, you still have the generator thing is to optimize the consumption and the production and the management of the batteries, make sure that the side of the original usage is always as minimum as possible. So this is the part where the research goes. And also, at the same time, from 2020 to 2023, there's knowledge transfer and dissemination, which goes from training and community with training and which includes training programs, support for operation and maintenance. They have technical paper, knowledge transfer, information session to the meeting member that happens all over the construction and the implementation with the information sessions and the training sessions for meeting members. Creation and installation of interpretation panels and public visit of the installation. So, I will leave you talk about the work to do to design feasibility study for the project.
So after we met with Josh and Sam and Walter and maybe what I think that was it, that are here today, that were there last winter, we went on to do what we call a pre-feasibility study. So after we met, it was determined that it would be really nice to basically try and eliminate diesel consumption at the end of the day. And we went back to our drawing tables to try and figure out what would be a nice way to do that. Mauricio was here, was our main analyst on the project. We came up with a design that includes solar panels and batteries. And the idea was to also maintain the diesel generator on one hand because we want the reliability and we want to make sure that there's no issues with the commissioning and getting started with a 100% renewable energy project. But also because there's a little uncertainty as well as to how much power do we actually need, how much energy is consumed. We don't have a lot of data on the consumption of the cache. I mean, we know approximately how many liters per year, but you know, what we also know is that when they're cooking dinners and the washing machines are on for the sheets from the rooms, power trips. So we had an idea of how much peak load would be, but so we came up with the design of, I think there might be some information about this further, but about 35 kilowatts of solar energy represents 134 panels. We can talk about it later. Okay. So this is the preliminary design that we came up with. We built the budget, and we were estimating overall costs, but it's a high level estimation. So really, in order to get down to the details, we actually need to get started on the project, which is in the first phase that Francois was presenting earlier. So what we've estimated is that basically these figures here are really hard to read, but the main lodge we estimated consumes around 35,000 kilowatt hours per year. And then there's hotel rooms that add another 3,000 kilowatts. So that was the estimated load that we had. And we designed a system to cover that. Now, I was talking about solar panels and batteries. And just want to take a step back for a second and have a look at this little figure right here. Now, basically, solar panels will only generate electricity when they're sun, right? The lodge and the rooms are going to consume electricity whenever they need it, when they're cooking at night, whenever there's, well, heating comes from biomass, but so the production of solar energy doesn't necessarily match the production, the usage of electricity. So this is very typical for these small grids. And that's why we're talking about batteries as well. So the idea is that you can store the energy that's produced from the sun in the batteries when you're not using it, and then you can use the energy from the batteries when the sun isn't there. So we've sized up solar panels and batteries, and we have a few figures right here, 35,000 watts or 35 kilowatts of solar energy. We produce an estimated 40,000 kilowatt hours, so that's roughly from the last slide what the consumption of the cache is. And then we have some batteries. We mentioned Tesla here because that's what we had in our data, but it doesn't have to be Tesla batteries. The Tesla battery that we were looking at, or any other battery, would have a power of 50 kilowatts and an autonomy of 2 days. So based on, so it would be able to discharge for 34 kilowatt hours, which based on our assumptions on how much the cache is consuming, the cache would be able to live without sun for 2 days. And then that's when the generators come in. And the whole idea of that backup is that you can turn on the generators, stock up the battery, and run for another few days. Another interesting point here is that when you use a diesel generator in that way, you're always operating your diesel generator in a sweet spot, which means that it's consuming less diesel per, say, kilowatt hour of electricity produced. And so we can optimize the generator, make it live longer, and it will require less maintenance. Here are a few more figures. I think the most important thing here to look at is that, and again, I want to take a step back. The idea that the reason we started on this college journey or started putting together this project together is that we were aware of the cache, or I guess the Gesgapegiag's intentions to buy a new generator or to find an alternative source of energy. Now, by buying a new generator, what we're trying to, well, the way this project is built at the moment is that we would leverage the investment of that generator in order to get funding from Natural Resources Canada to install the PV system, the solar system, and the battery. So, overall, we expect at this stage that the investment in solar and storage would come mostly from Natural Resources Canada, and that at the end of the day, the outcome that we're expecting to see is that we've estimated that in diesel and operational costs, it's roughly costing around $12,000 a year. With the solar and battery system installed, we would expect diesel consumption to drop dramatically. Let's say that it would be around $2,000 a year. The maintenance of the solar and batteries would be around $1,000 a year. So we're estimating roughly around $9,000 of saving per year once the project is up and running.
So the last part of the project, which is the knowledge transfer and dissemination, is part of customized training programs for construction people and operating people, maintenance people later on. Not too much support from the academics project for the maintenance and operation and construction. The technical reports that will be written by Nashika here about the microgrid implementation and remote site. Guided tools with community member, the awareness promotion for community implementation panels. This is the last part of the project. We expect to achieve 100% renewable energy, but we have to keep a margin because it might be some case where it's not possible, so we say 80 to 100% energy, which the goal is 100%.
So is it a requirement then to have cards?
For depends on what, for example, for education.
Yes.
Yes.
But for the workforce, I don't work construction, but in the U.S. is a construction in Quebec. For a developer, you need cards. But for SMB, no. I don't know. But mostly for construction, I expect, yes, that's on the contractor. But this is, we're remarking about it, it's very important for the GDP, I said, I don't. And it's very early in the project to say, especially with any penetration, with any temperature, it's too early. It's the direct, like we know in the electrician, right, producing electricity. But then after that, it's when you go further on the project that you can see exactly how many people. And we have a year. We plan a year for project designs, which gives time to train people. So it's not going to be a rush construction as quick as possible in order to get the people trained and able to do this work. And it's an alternative, it's a possibility if you have those people trained. And the goal of this project is to be predictable, that we can copy, not exactly, but kind of copy paste this project on the sites. Then that's why it's important to get those people trained properly.
I'm going to be converting to solar panel as well.
Sorry?
I'm going to be converting, I have a cabin.
Yeah.
And I'll be converting to solar panel. Uh-huh. Am I entitled for a training tool for this panel? It's like a small business that I'm going to be running. I have panels already.
Yeah.
I'm going to have them installed. I have the batteries.
Sure.
And I have the converter.
Yeah.
It would make sense to have training.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Because I have a 10,000 watt generator already. I don't need that much watts, maybe 6,000 watts. But I don't know how much solar panel do I need.
I give you my part of it. We can have a look at it together. It's my duty at the Gesgapegiag to do those projects. So this is, it's not part of the Gesgapegiag, but we offer the service to all community members of any First Nation Quebec.
Okay.
So this is going to come later on, because I didn't know that we can do it now, because the training program is going to start in 2 years or like after the project. Yeah, the difference, sorry to say, but like construction people, they have different training accessible to them because it's professional. If you go for other projects, then we can look at the opportunities after. And for general people, training is going to be developed at the end of maybe the project, the public business, and everything. Again, I guess the production for people.
Okay. But with my approach, it's not that complicated.
No.
No.
Basic.
Yeah.
But you have a manual and.
But if you go to the microgrid step, gets a lot more complicated.
Yeah.
Because it's a bigger system.
But I think François is going to be offering training or support much sooner than when this project is going to be deployed. So,
so if you have the panel and every day already, it's going to be quicker to go directly with me. Because this is what I do.
Another thing I'd like to add here is the primary objective is to displace the diesel at the attach through this program. But we've been calling it the flagship program, and we're not. I don't think it's too ambitious to say that, because there aren't that many projects that we know of that aim to displace 100% of their diesel. So the reason we think and we want to emphasize on the training on one side, it's for the community members to own and operate and understand how their system works. But if this becomes reproducible, you will be among the first in Canada to deploy these systems and to know how they work and operate them. And you could become champions in other communities. communities, and not only transfer your own knowledge, but also be part of other projects and other communities as well. So it could be, this could become a bit of a hub for renewable energy, say. And I think there's going to be multiple projects that are going to appear throughout the country in the next few years. This program has been active for about a year now, and it's probably going to continue for a few years. But it'd be great if, you know, if that expertise could be developed here in the Gesgapegiag. So there's, you know, there's a bit of that cash, but there's something bigger behind it as well.
Have you worked on the implementation?
Have we?
Yeah.
So we've worked a little bit with the Yukon. There's a professor out there at a college who we're collaborating with. We have a partner in our research project that's the village, but it's a Cree nation in Quebec. We've just started working with Gesgapegiag about a year ago. We have a project with Bush as well. So it's kind of new for us, to be honest. But very open. I hope we have many more projects to come.
Well, it only makes sense that if the cash is going to be needed, and then there's future opportunities down the road for private business such as Maple cabins up on 299, that they open it to everyone. Now, the comment that I wanted to make was traditionally, when there's construction projects that are tied to demand, not necessarily going to the only thing I think we have for sure is the advanced construction data courses. And depending on your alignment, but in the last 10 years, there has been at least 100 people that have been trained in different areas. We're looking at bracketing some of the people that are in carpentry. We're also looking at working with the millwrights who are missing some components for the windmill, and we're going to be doing all the mechanical training. So I think there's quite a bit already out there trained, but it opens up a lot. When I think of the students that are coming up, the younger generation, and we're always talking about student land and we need to work together. There's an opportunity for the young adults because the Ministry of Education is also coming out with a robotics program to the adult ed sector. And we're looking at coding, so we're trying to work a little bit behind. It's gone more to the province first, but it'll come to First Nations next. And so we'll be ready whenever that time comes. And it would be a fantastic project initiative to talk to the youth about it.
One thing I'd like to add, Francois and I have done a lot of talking. It's mainly because we've managed to put some resources to prepare this project, but maybe unlike other projects that are promoted by, say, a private company and then where they find community partners, this year is, if we go forward, it would be a project that where the main promoter is Gesgapegiag. And so the money from AirCan would go to you, and then and then you would decide who you hire, who is, our objective in this project would be to work for you, basically. We wouldn't be calling shots for anything. We'd be making recommendations. Hopefully providing you with sound advice.
Another question?
Does the cache own the generator?
Pardon me?
Does the cache own the generator?
Well, the two generators that we've been going on for the past few years, we've been going on them. Right now, they've been running for at least probably 20 some years, and they're seeing its last days. In the past month, we've been, Bonnie and Jerome has been working really hard to get us a replacement generator for the time being until we can see what's our future plans. So right now, we're renting a generator, and so far, it's been not a good for 2 weeks. It's been really good.
But it's not a plan to keep renting a generator?
No. It was just something that we needed because the snowmobile season was just right there. We're in the middle of the snowmobile season, and it was something that we couldn't wait to see if we can get approved to buy a new generator. It was something that we needed really, really quickly, so that's what we're doing. So far, it's been our first month that we can see what we're doing. I know the generator that we rented is up for sale, so we're going to see what we're on a 90-day trial right now and see what generator is right now and where it's at. If it's going to continue to do what it's been doing for the past 2 weeks, then maybe that's going to be an option.
So does anybody have any questions or comments, concerns? You can always email myself, walter.jerome@gesgapegiag.ca, joshua.bradstreet@gesgapegiag.ca, samuel.mcginnis@gesgapegiag.ca, and then we can try to find the answers for you in communication with our partners here. We're going to be putting the presentation up on gesgapegiag.ca website, so that's our community website.